This episode, I talk about brain-computer interfaces with Slava Bobrov, a machine learning engineer applying AI to neural signals to control robotic limbs. This podcast will be of special interest to you if you're willing to get started with brain-computer interfaces or are broadly interested in how this technology could enhance human intelligence. Fun fact, most of the questions were asked by my Twitter followers or come from a Discord I co-created on brain-computer interfaces. So if you want to be in the next video or just want to chat about BCI, the link for my Twitter and Discord will be in the description. Now, without further ado, here's my chat with Slava. Before we talk about your work, maybe we can define a bit brain-computer interfaces for people who have never heard of it.
When it comes to brain-computer interfaces, imagine if you could control your computer or your mobile phone without hands. You could just think about clicking on something and it would happen. That's the idea to reduce, to improve our interfaces of communication with the digital world. So we don't actually need to spend any muscle energy. So you can go through this digital medium faster.
Do you think there's a limit to how much bandwidth we can increase? Because when we read, we're kind of bottlenecked by, our reading speed. When we listen, we cannot hold too much information in our brain. Do you think brain-computer interfaces can bypass this limit?
When it comes to really, really advanced brain-computer interface, so not the ones that we currently have, but in the future, if it's connected to our biological brain, there is a limitation on the speed of communication between neurons. Okay, so even though there is electricity involved when these neurons kind of firing, there are still chemical junctions between neurons where communication is chemical, which limits the speed. It serves a purpose in the brain, but that's the threshold. Now,
you mean neurotransmitters in synapses, right?
Exactly. Yes, the neurotransmitters. So, if we can deal with that and actually maybe in the future replace neurons to some kind of artificial neurons which do not have those limitations, that's when we can talk about increasing the speed. But this is this will change everything if we go that direction.
Awesome. Yeah, we'll go into that later. I guess for people who have never heard of you and will know more about AI, could you talk about who's the person behind those glasses and what's the work you're doing in brain-computer interface?
So I work with neurotech companies. So neurotech that involves brain-computer interfaces, that involves prosthetics. Currently, I'm involved I work with a startup where we develop prosthetic hands. For amputees, and I work on analysis of neural signals, applying machine learning in order to make the control of the prosthetic hand more intuitive. For example, you can think of movement, of your limb, and the hand would move accordingly. That's not the case with the current prosthetic hands that are on the market. You actually need to learn how to operate them. It's like another tool. But with machine learning, you can kind of reduce the friction and make it closer to how you would operate a human hand. So that's one thing. I also do consultancy and advising to neurotech startups. Previously, I worked with neurofeedback to help people fall asleep faster, for example, people who have insomnia. So I would read brain signals and based on that I would develop algorithms that could adjust specific feedback that was given to a person, so the person changes their state without actually taking any kind of too much effort. Yeah.
So would it be changing state with like neuromodulation, or what would be the feedback?
It was completely non-invasive, and the state was adjusted with sound. Yeah. So like there is a whole science on how we can apply sound for neurofeedback. Like there are these kind of popular ones that they call them binaural beats, like when you have different frequencies in your that are directed in your ears. But like apart from that, you can also you can basically apply sound as a way to change a person's state. You can notice that when you listen to the music, like different music changes your state. You wouldn't listen like rock to fall asleep unless you pretty special. But that's like you pick a proper kind of music depending on the brain activity.
And yeah, for the company you're working for now, for the prosthetic ends, do you do mostly data analysis or hardware, robotics?
I mostly work on the software side. But also, like, this is one of the best thing about startups. You can do, in a startup, if you want to do something, like, in terms of if you want to expand your responsibilities, and that can be helpful for a startup, you should. So you can actually kind of get out of your kind of common responsibilities, and you can do, like, other things. So, like, in the past, I also helped, like, with a little bit with operations and like how the startup actually runs, because I do have like project management experience. So like this is that I would advise everybody to try with it, like to work in a startup to your learning curve changes a lot.
Yeah, you get to learn a bunch of different things on doing a bunch of different jobs. So yeah, what's the name of the company if people want to join?
Ether Biomedical. It's called Ether Biomedical.
And so your clients are mostly people who are disabled, I guess.
Yes. So amputee. I don't even call them. They're humans. Really, when you start to work with people who lack limbs, you just realize it's just a periphery. You know, when you see them like replacing their hand with another hand, you kind of get used to that, and you realize in the future I might do the same. I mean, once we kind of get even more advanced, I mean, eventually it will come to everybody. If you have an intention to live longer, if you have an intention to kind of expand or augment your capabilities, it's periphery.
Yeah, and I think for Paralympics, maybe even Olympics, people, there's like someone running with a prosthetic leg, maybe not a prosthetic leg, but something that helped him run faster, and it was faster than most humans. I'm not sure if it's right. Have you heard of it?
I haven't heard about the results in terms of like did they do something faster, but yes, there is a whole science on how you kind of it's not just it's not a simple device. There is a lot of things that are going on. If we are talking about leg prosthesis, there is some calculation inside of it to make it feel like to adjust like there is sort of like a feedback that's going on because you put in a weight on it and it has to feel natural.
So yeah, you've talked about feedback and prosthetic arms. What are like broadly, if you were to define, different kind of interfaces we could have between like medical, consumers, invasive, non-invasive, like how do you define those in like broad categories?
Okay, yes, we can start from dividing them on invasive and non-invasive.
Mm-hmm.
It hasn't been defined yet which technology is going to be kind of the future. Yeah, which technology is more superior. Like it's kind of, we can assume like invasive technology, like just logically because it goes directly, but we don't know. Maybe there will be advancement on the non-invasive.
Just to be clear, when people talk about invasive, sometimes they mention the skull as a limit, like if you need to do surgery, and non-invasive would be something that doesn't require surgery. Would you agree with that definition?
Exactly. So like with invasive, you can either drill a hole in your skull, or you can also go through your blood vessels and deploy electrode arrays that will be kind of, it's kind of invasive, but it's without like drilling like large holes. So, but it's definitely something that goes inside of your body. With non-invasive, there is no like physically there is kind of, in terms of material there is nothing that is goes inside. It's like it's all done non-invasively, either with detecting electrical signal from the top of your scalp or doing some kind of imaging,
even the thing where you send sound. If you because there is input and output, you can record what the brain is doing, and then you can input stuff like sound in the ears, or you can do modulation as well. Would you, when you try to send, when you do neuromodulation via waves, does it count as invasive or not when you send stuff?
No, this is not invasive because, like, I mean, even though like waves are physical, is a physical phenomenon, like it's not, it's it is counted as non-invasive.
Okay, and just to like for people who are not in the space, I know some companies like I think most people have heard of Neuralink, especially people who know about Elon Musk. That is aimed to be invasive with electrodes implanted in the brain. For the sound, I think one of people also know is Muse. Do you have like other companies that people could learn more about? Oh yeah, maybe can you describe Muse as well because we haven't talked about it.
Muse. Okay. So Muse is this kind of simple brain computer interface that is non-invasive. You can buy it, and like the company Interaxon sells it for the purpose of mainly for the purpose of meditation, guided meditation. So basically, you put a device like a band on your head and. You plug in like your headphones, and so it starts to record your brain activity. And depending on your brain activity, it will give you sound feedback on how relaxed or how focused you are. So when you are meditating, it's very important for you to stay focused, and that the thoughts are not distracting, and you can actually detect that with brain waves in terms of how focused you are. So they provide feedback to help you get in that state of where you like meditating and there are no distractions, like thought distractions. That's like primary kind of application, but people use it also for different things, like there is like an SDK that you can use to just use your brain waves,
So SDK is software development kit. So if people want to program themselves, the thing.
Yes. And people also like develop their own kind of interfaces, like Bluetooth interfaces that you can basically use to stream raw EEG signal. EEG, that's the signal from your from your brain waves. Like non-invasive signal and electrical signal. It stands for it's something that you can read, and it has four different channels, so you can think of different times, four different time series, and you can do some analysis, and that's usually one of the ways how people can start in BCIs.
So you're talking about people buying their own kit and they plug things on top of their head, like sensors. So some kids like for EEG signals from something like OpenBCI, where I think it costs a few hundred bucks, right?
Yes. Okay. So for OpenBCI, it's a different story because OpenBCI is specifically for developers. Okay, you basically receive like a PCB and wires and electrodes, and you connect them. It's kind of very
okay. So you're saying Muse also has those sensors. And,
yes, the difference is Muse primary kind of application is not developed for building something on top of it. That's mm-hmm. not its. Its goal is to provide people and reach kind of more like general audience who have no idea about brain-computer interfaces, but who are interested in meditation. When it comes to, so you mentioned OpenBCI. OpenBCI, if you want to start with seriously with brain-computer interfaces, I think it's even better to start with OpenBCI, because not only you will have a more comprehensive picture on how to how to work with both hardware and software, but there is also a large community behind it, and people forums are always active, and there are plenty of articles, plenty of videos on how to connect with very simple steps, how to easily connect and start recording the data. So it's like, I think for development, OpenBCI is usually the choice.
Yeah, so before people want to study a brain signal time series and do their own kind of data science project, yeah. I think there are some different levels of invasive and non-invasive that we haven't talked about. So, for instance, Kernel, I don't think the current Kernel, so the company by Brian Johnson, I think they released a product either this year or last year that's not really EEG signals, but it's still non-invasive. Do you know what kind of signal they use?
Yes, they use something like, it's called fNIRS. So it's the difference between fNIRS and, or they use some kind of advanced version of it. But basically, what it records not the electrical signal that comes from your neurons, but it records the level of blood or blood oxygenation, I think. If you want to know which brain area is currently active, you can record electrical signal, and electrical signal will be more stronger and it will have certain patterns in it. So you can say, okay, this kind of area is active. But also neurons that are activating, they require blood flow. Okay, they require kind of resources for them to get activated. So with a certain delay, 1 second, 2 second, blood and oxygen arrives to that brain area, and you can also detect that. So what's the downside? The downside is the delay. So it's not real time, in terms of it's not like what's happening right now is what you record. It's actually kind of delayed signal with 1 or 2 seconds delay. It's semi real time, but still it's very useful. I mean, and they are scaling it up to kind of having a lot of those sensors, which, if you look at the pictures, you can see how they kind of do some kind of interpolation and map the brain areas and their activations.
Yeah, there's this podcast with Brian Johnson and Lex Friedman where you can see the device and how it maps to the different areas of the brain. Yeah. I would highly recommend it. It still feels weird to record things happening with blood flows. It seems very hard to measure the things.
What do you mean?
So you said it was it dealt with things happening with blood flow before neuron activation.
Mm-hmm.
So it seems harder to detect this than electricity in the brain.
It's not harder. It's different. For example, when it comes to electricity, it's very noisy. There are a lot of artifacts. You can pick up line noise, 60 hertz or 50 hertz, literally, and it will be visible. So you can need to filter that out. There is also any kind of movement that you do with your eye blinks, with your jaw clenching. Yeah, any muscle activations of your like facial expressions, it will be visible on EEG. And there are certain techniques that you can apply to filter them out, but still it's very noisy. Yeah. With fNIRS, it's different because you're not recording electricity there.
Okay. Yeah. I think there are like a lot of body signals that we can record that even muscle. I think we haven't talked about muscle. So there's EEG and there's also EMG.
Yes.
And that's one thing you're especially interested in, like for your prosthetics.
Yeah, so that's one way. Okay, so the EMG stands for electromyography, and it records like, so you have like central neural system, that's your brain and spinal cord, but you also have a peripheral, nervous system, and you can record signals from that system as well. And the big difference is with EEG, electroencephalography, you have billions and billions of brain cells, and it's kind of the analogy that usually like one can give. If imagine a stadium, yeah, and imagine that you want to record and kind of understand what people are speaking about. So you can just go with your microphone and listen to each person and like what they're talking about. But EEG, so that's like listening to a specific neuron. Could be the metaphor, but EEG is something like listening from outside of the stadium to the whole crowd chanting. So you can't actually understand what each individual person is saying, but you can kind of detect waves. Like you can detect general patterns that are more like not local but like more global patterns. And so with the difference with EEG and EMG, with EMG you're usually much closer to the source. It's not behind your skull, and there is not a lot of nerves compared to neurons. Yeah, so like you can record and the signal is much stronger and it's much simpler. So in terms of controlling something, you are currently with this kind of technology, will be better off using EMG to, if you want to kind of control something remotely.
Yeah, it feels like EMG would be kind of controlling the nerve by some kind of Ethernet cable directly plugged in someone in the stadium, whereas with EEG you would just be hearing the song from the team.
I think if we like take if we kind of continue this analogy with EMG, it would not be a stadium, it would be some kind of a classroom where people are still chanting, but you can kind of or some kind of a party. So you are inside of a party and you can't actually bring the microphone closer to each person, but if you put a microphone kind of closer to the room, with certain techniques, you can kind of, there's a cocktail party. I think there's a problem in understanding kind of what kind of components are included in the signal and to kind of split them out and analyze them separately. Like, for example, like something like independent component analysis in machine learning. That would be like the analogy. It would not be. It would be a much smaller group of people.
Right. I think now we have a good understanding of the different kinds. Maybe we left some, but we could go back later. Mm. Just personally, what kind of device or company is doing work that you think it's underrated? Like most people don't know about it, but they should know about it.
I think that, first of all, there are a lot of companies in this field that people just outside of this field are not aware of. And I think the field itself is underrated because, we do have like companies that go outside of the field and you hear about them, like Neuralink, yeah. I think we need more people to get the awareness of this field, because it's literally the future of our, like, the way how we communicate with digital world. So the earlier you get, the better it is for you, and like you can impact the field, you can contribute to the field. So I think I would say that most of the companies in the field are underrated.
Okay. And this is another question from Discord on neurotech. What I want to know, what's your ideal neurotech device? Like, if you could have anything in the next few years, what would you want?
Okay, my ideal, let's see. I would say the one that allows it to be used on a global scale. So the one that would be safe for people to use, and also it has a high temporal and spatial resolution, so you can record in real time, and it's like a high fidelity, high quality kind of recording, and you can record from small, like you can listen to those single individuals, like single neurons, and possibly stimulate them in a safe way. So that resolution, when you can access almost like virtually every neuron in the brain, with a kind of, and you can record from not just one person in the stadium, but from the every person in the stadium, which is like we have some kind of a way to go to that stage. But that would be sort of the holy grail when we, once we achieve real time, like high spatial resolution kind of signal.
So yes, something where you can, people safely can record. I think those things are kind of opposite, right? If you can record everything, or like be very precise, it would probably be invasive or require surgery. I don't see a future where we could, you know, with EEG record very precisely what's in, and if it's inside our brain, by definition, it will be like not safe. Or we can have like very precise robots. But yeah, I don't see. So I know Neuralink is building robots that are very precise to implant electrodes. I don't know how precise you should be to be considered safe. And even if they're like very precise, I think the same thing with self-driving cars. Like, even if the robots are very precise, people will not be open to surgeries because they think there's a risk. And they don't see the risk in human surgeons.
Yes, that's true. That's true. And we currently do not have the technology for like a completely safe, invasive brain-computer interface. I think it would be a kind of iterative process where you have a closed feedback loop between, like, once you deploy a system and you kind of test it, you fix, you deploy again, improved iteration, you fixed again. So yeah, as usual, like iterative progress, how we got where we are with our current technologies.
And do you think we will have brain surgeons using brain computer interfaces to operate on patients?
Yeah, that's meta. it's possible. The thing is, why Neuralink wants to deploy robots is because, first of all, even if you are super precise, like as a surgeon, there is a still kind of a time to where you can kind of insert something. Like, it takes like physical manipulation to kind of insert something in the brain, whereas with robot, it's like if you're precise with what you do, it's all limited by, you know, by rather hardware, which is kind of, I think, will be superior. So that's,
and
where robots,
software bugs as well, like if you have people, even if the like hardware is perfect and precise enough, if someone has made a mistake in the software, there could be a crash.
Yes. The same for the autopilot. That's why it requires like iterative improvement.
So yeah, in more recent news, I think yesterday we had Facebook, Instagram, and WhatsApp who crashed for several hours. The entire servers were down and we could not access it for that much time. So yeah, imagine a year, I don't know, in a decade or something, where people have invasive BCIs in their brains. What if everything shut down and you know, someone hacks into their system? Did you follow the events yesterday? Were you shocked by it?
Or? I was not, but I was in the meetings with people and they were like saying something, WhatsApp doesn't work, like I can't contact that person, this person. I wasn't aware like of the in real time. But regarding your question with regards to if that happens with brain-computer interfaces, well, it's a possibility, yes. I mean, if something is like, if there is a probability of this happening, it could happen. And
so would you connect your brain to, you know, a Facebook company or a company that can be shut down, attacked by hackers?
So like personally right now, where we are in our current development, I would not connect myself to Facebook. My hope is they will change, like in terms of how they kind of how their engagement system works, because how they started, it's not how it is right now. I mean, they started with kind of this goal of connecting people, which is like BCIs are kind of aiming to the similar goal. So they just got, I think, with such amount of people, they literally can't handle that. They just literally it's literally an alive system, an alarm kind of swarm intelligence that is going on with 2+ billion people are being online, like being in the system, where Facebook just is not handling that well. I mean, I don't know about their internal process, but I would imagine that it's not a very easy task to do.
So your take is that humans are hard to control by masses, and if you have like a model, economic model, where you need to kind of use those humans as users, and you have a large amount, then there will be problems or.
It gives you a glimpse of what the future, and for example, even AI, that once a system kind of is just literally many brains connected, they are just connected in a very slow way where you still need to type. I'm talking about Facebook here. It's still lots and lots of brain combined with an artificial intelligence that runs like the algorithms. That's a system. That's an alive system on its own. And I think like we are already facing the kind of the challenges of how to control that and how to predict that. We should learn from that in order like the. We will need to deal with such situation on a much larger scale in the future, so we need to adjust right now.
Yeah, and I think when you say like AI helping you type, I think there's been autocorrect for a long time. There's also been now Gmail or other messaging apps that help you like guess what you're going to type, that helps you write faster text. And yeah, more recently there's been GitHub Copilots or Codex that helps you write code. And yeah, I think from one of our conversations you told me that Codex is a step towards next generation BCI, and that it's a form of BCI in itself. And I find this thing fascinating. Could you explain a bit more what you mean?
Yeah, so if you think about not how BCI looks like, but actually its primary functionality, that's to reduce the time that it takes from your thought to materialize, to impact the external world. Yeah. So for example, with brain computer interface, you can kind of control like toy cars using your brain, yeah? And you don't need any like manual input, you're just thinking about it. So the time it takes for you to kind of do something is less. It's similar to Codex from like GPT, like GPT-3 Codex from OpenAI. The difference, like the similarity is basically what system allows you to do is it reduces the time from your idea to your like once it originates in your brain to kind of the time when it becomes physical, when you kind of create the program, create the software, and that's the idea behind BCI. So
it reduces the distance between like neuron firing and happening in a computer.
Exactly. And also, which is very important, energy that it takes to do that. Because not only like physical energy, but also like the amount of steps that you need to run mentally. When you code, you are very concentrated. A lot of things are happening. And so it takes you more energy, which somehow even converts into more time to achieve something that you want. With Codex, it allows you to do that in a less amount of time without thinking about a lot of details. And that's like the system will go to the path of least resistance.
Yeah, I think there's something else where, you know, there's many users using Codex to write code. So it kind of guesses the pattern we have a bit like Stack Overflow. When you type something on Google, we have a question. It guesses what problems we have from our past searches. Here is like, yeah, go ahead.
It thinks for you.
Yeah. So if it maybe that's a bit too specific to talk about the brain, but if it kind of guesses the patterns happening in your brain, so before when a neuron fires, it kind of can suggest and you type. It can suggest like things that you might want to read because it kind of guessed what's the architecture in your brain and what are you going to be able to understand.
Yeah.
And so sometimes when I use Codex or Copilot, most of the time, it kind of tell me something that I'm able to understand because, you know, I know Python, I know this library, and you just like write something and I'm like, oh yeah, that's cool. And it's not even like, yeah, it's helping me connect different parts of my brain that I didn't know that existed, those links.
Yeah. Yeah. When it comes to prediction, that's already happening in our brain in terms of neurons are kind of predicting what other neurons, like what would be the pattern of firing of other neurons. So it's prediction on top of prediction on top of prediction, like kind of in a hierarchical way. So it's already happening inside of our brains and it will propagate into external systems.
I think for dopamine, when you're trying to, you know, when you do something, you're trying to predict if you're going to get a reward or not. Most of the dopamine generation is trying to predict if you're doing something right or not. If you're doing a good job, it predicts something positive and rewards you. And if you did something bad, it thinks you're going to have a bad time later.
Yeah. Rewarding system is interesting from the point of like if you look at reinforcement learning in AI field, usually humans, so there, in reinforcement learning there is a thing where you basically can train your agent to operate in a like virtual environment, and the agent is very stupid in the beginning. It knows nothing, and you tell the person, for example, solve this, not the person, the agent, you tell solve this maze, and the kind of the agent doesn't even know that the maze exists. So if by trial and error the agent goes through this process of iteratively learning about the structure of the maze and eventually solving the puzzle, and the way to do that is to give rewarding function to this agent to kind of give some kind of optimization function, some kind of similar to how we have loss function in deep learning, and the key thing is we are the humans who give the rewarding function. The agent doesn't have access to its rewarding function. But in our case, in case of humans, the rewarding function is we have not kind of, at this kind of point of development, we do not know how it's been, how it works in a way that, how do you actually create a rewarding function that kind of is very adjustable, and agent kind of has access to rewarding function, because you do have access to your kind of dopamine system in an indirect way. You take sugar, you listen to the music, yeah? Mm-hmm. You can give yourself rewards, and people, that's how people get addiction. With brain-computer interfaces, that's one of the kind of things that can lead to a scary future. Like, imagine you have a direct stimulation into your reward pathways, and you feel like the level of orgasm almost. Yeah. So mm-hmm. how do you stop yourself from a stimulation? When they did like research on rats couldn't. Rats would just press the button and stimulate themselves. So that's an interesting thing. Like, how can we develop like a rewarding function in a way that is safe for us?
Yeah, I don't know about the neuroscience behind it, but when you take drugs, you can attack or trigger this dopaminergic pathways, and you have a bunch of serotonin or dopamine that is released. And you cannot take drugs for a long time, so you need to like wait a few days or a few weeks before everything comes together again. So I would expect that if you have some mechanism with BCI that creates dopamine, or not creates, but like make it go faster, then at some point you will be out of it, and you need to get some time to create more. So I don't know if you can like foster this creation with other tools, or if you need to wait for your organism to create that.
Yeah. So yes. So with drugs and with drugs, there is a thing called habituation, where like you basically become more you develop a habit of getting that amount of reward, and it's not as rewarding anymore. And it has like a physical process where on the level of neurons, like this synaptic junction, where you know it's kind of adjusts, and it for you to get to the level where you feel rewarded, you need more of that substance. I think with brain computer faces we could face the same thing, where the neurons, imagine like weights in neural networks, they will be just adjusted because of that, and it will be harder and harder to get the reward. But I can speak from like there were like studies in rats, and those rats had a choice whether I think to have food or have like an orgasm experience. So they had like buttons to choose, and they would choose the ones that would give them more reward, and they would die, I think, out of hunger.
Yeah, those are famous experiences about experiencing pleasure, and rats that choose pleasure. I think humans could, like, if we implement timer, like after an hour it goes out, then you'll be forced to like stop. Okay, and yeah. So I guess one of your goals is to like make BCIs more accessible to more people. We've talked a bit about like some tools like OpenBCI or. That you can buy online and put on yourself to learn data science and BCI. What is like some, like, so I think the audience is mostly like data scientists or people learning about AI. What are some fun deep learning projects that people could take, like some open source data set or something that could like, get their hands started to learn about BCI with the point of view of deep learning or data science?
Okay, so if you do not have your own BCI, which I recommend getting, because it's much more fascinating to work with your signals, There are plenty of data sets, even on Kaggle, you can find some, where there are even like tasks on Kaggle where you can analyze brain data. But trust me, that's not as fascinating as actually getting your, you can get it for a very cheap price and you can start analyzing your own data. That's much more, you get much more kind of reward from that because you learn about yourself a lot, so that gives you a motivation to progress further, and you also apply the algorithms not only in kind of offline mode where you have just a bunch of data, but you also can apply your algorithms to real-time streaming as it goes. You can look at your signal, you can develop some algorithms that run in parallel, and you look at some metrics and maybe even like define like some kind of a neurofeedback protocols where you can, once a certain threshold is reached, do this, like play this sound. Or if you want to control a game, you can basically like define, okay, if this threshold or this threshold, so that's without deep learning, do this or that type of control. With deep learning, you can enhance that and kind of don't care much about thresholds and stuff. You just plug in the signal into your system, maybe do some pre-processing, but even without pre-processing, you can plug in into a deep learning system and you can define the output, like the kind of the cost function that you optimize for. And for example, if you want to detect whether you're thinking left or thinking right, for example, if you want to control a movement of a car, in a game, and you want to do that without your hands, you can kind of deploy a deep learning algorithm that would train on your data, and you can then like think left or right and move the car in accordance to that.
Okay, so controlling some kind of car in a game with your like a EEG signal or something, and and then the kind of AI would be classifying if you're thinking about left or right, classifying left or right. And how do you know if there's like any that data sets of people thinking about left or right, up and down?
There probably is there is a whole video series by a guy who does some kind of coding tutorials, Stendex or something like that's the channel on YouTube, where he did a playlist on exactly this problem, controlling your car in Grand Theft Auto with like your brain, like with open BCI. So he has, I think, even articles how he did that, and obviously the videos. It has a lot of views, I think. So I would start from there, because this guy, he has no knowledge of neuroscience, he has no knowledge of BCIs, and he did achieve the control. So just using the software engineering skills. So I would like advise people to, you know, you got to be driven not by how complex the algorithm are, but how exciting the problem is for you to resolve.
Right. Yeah. I guess controlling your car with your brain allows you to think about like who to kill and how to get more stars in GTA.
Yeah. Have you
tried those things, or have you built one thing yourself outside of companies?
Plenty. So I'm very interested in sleep and like dreaming, and like applying BCIs to that area. So I actually kind of recorded my brain signals in real time while falling asleep, because I was always kind of interested what happens in the moment when you fall asleep. When is that moment when you kind of shut down and you drop into deep sleep? Now, I did that, and I analyzed I developed like this software that allows you to plot everything in real time, a lot of metrics that allows you to kind of have like a pilot cockpit where you can see everything. And once you fall asleep, you do not have a visual input, so you can use some kind of sound cues to kind of tell, okay, now you're in this brain state, and you can kind of consciously fall asleep and Later, for example, watch a recording of literally your video recording of how you felt asleep, and in parallel I also would attach like a brain signal that goes in parallel, and I would kind of see at which moment what happens, what kind of brain patterns are happening.
How do you see someone like falling asleep? Was it like with infrared light, and you see the person in the dark closing it? No, because the eyes are always closed. Like the movement start, you stop moving. What do you do when you fall asleep?
So you have like, for example, EEG headset where it's still, your brain is still active, so it records the activity of the brain and nothing more. Even though you're not moving, your brain is kind of processing something, and that's what you record. Or what do you mean?
Oh, sorry. I thought you had like a camera to like compare when you were asleep and when you were and you could compare it to the signals of the brain.
Yes. Okay. So why I used camera? Because you also want to understand. On the camera, you could see kind of the level of relaxation of how, like, when you fall asleep, your muscles completely relax, and you can see how relaxed you are. But that's number one. Number two, I also use that to understand. Sometimes you wake up when you sleep, and you don't have any memory of that. So I wanted to see, and you kind of wake up not just completely wake up, but just kind of to turn you around, yeah, or like to maybe even like some people say something when they dream. So I wanted to record that and see what is the correlation between it and the signal.
Yeah, makes sense. What pattern did you observe? What was the waves or like what's the moment? How do you see them? Can you like now look at the data and see with your raw eyes when the person falls asleep?
Yeah, there are some. Okay, there are some brain waves that are they are like high frequency waves and slow frequency waves. High frequency waves are usually for the brain activity when you're like very alert, and low frequency waves are usually for when you are relaxed or asleep. So you have delta, theta, alpha, beta, gamma kind of bands. So I detected, if you go technical, I detected some theta bursts while I was falling asleep, which I was not, and I kind of read about them what they mean. And interesting thing that is happening, your eyes start to jiggle around when you kind of when you fall asleep. There is a moment when your eyes start to go back and forth for like a couple of seconds, like they just not even jiggle, but they kind of they move in a very not how they move in waking world. But apart from that, I also like, that's when falling asleep. What another interesting thing is very interested in lucid dreaming, and that's something when you you are conscious inside of your dream. You are conscious that you are aware that you are in the dream, something like Inception, if you remember the movie, similar to that. You are aware that you are dreaming, and I wanted to understand what is the moment, how the brain patterns are look, and you have a lot of eye movement during that time, so it's, you kind of need to differentiate between brain patterns and eye movements. But there's a lot of interesting things. See, that's my passion. With regards to sleep, you can use that for different purposes, for sleep or to control something or to just monitor your state. If you want to kind of learn even meditation, you can see kind of your progress in data, how are how you are improving, not just from subjective experience. Okay, I feel like I'm a master meditation right now, but actually from how well are you in control of your brainwaves? Yeah, and that will give you a more objective evaluation.
Did you try to get some to record yourself while lucid dreaming, or is it more like techniques when you wake up, go back to your dreams, and it's more like mind exercise where you try to force yourself to do things after waking up, or noticing when you are awake or sleeping or dreaming?
Yeah, I remember that. Like there is a moment when you fall asleep when you feel like you're falling, like it's almost like you're dropping. It's hard to explain, but I'm sure you're aware of that moment when you actually you are like conscious, and then you feel this kind of I wanted to detect that. I wanted to see what's behind it. And the way how I used camera, I would, and I also like recorded the sound. When that would happen, I would try to keep awareness during that moment, and I would signal back like by saying something or just by moving a little bit like a finger, just because you don't want to wake up yourself too much, just to see what are the brain signals related to that. Because like imagine if you can induce that state kind of on purpose, like you can train yourself just like you train yourself to meditate. What if you can train yourself to like stay aware while you fall asleep? You can do that with lucid dreaming without any brain computer interfaces, but it takes practice. What if you can improve on that?
Sounds super cool. Yeah, I want to record everything now and see when exactly I fall asleep. I think another interest of yours that we didn't talk about yet is the kind of long-term future of BCI and also AI. So we both read Ray Kurzweil's books on singularities near, or I think it's the age of machines,
spiritual
machines. So it was those are kind of old books. So it was, I think, the singularity is near is, 15 years ago. So I think one of the reasons, so if I remember correctly, one of the reasons you like wanted to learn about BCI and practice them is both because you're interested in the actual science, but as well, you think they have they could have a role to play in this kind of, competition between AI and human intelligence. Can you maybe reframe that or nuance it?
Yeah, so I really want like humans and AI to kind of cooperate and collaborate. So competition would be, I wouldn't like if there is a competition between humans and AI, because AI is our creation. It's like our child, the child of our mind. Let's say, it's like it's not biological, but it's we have thoughts, we have ideas, and they can be considered as our children in a way, like how we kind of populate the world with our ideas. But those ideas, they just move like they are information. They just move from one person to another, and they can record it somewhere on the web page or in a book. But those ideas don't do anything on their own, in terms of they don't have any kind of sensory input and motor output. That's what AI will do. That it will give our ideas kind of, it will make them more alive, it's definitely something that we are in the AI field. We are definitely moving towards that. People who say that we are far away from such progress, just look at historical data, just compare 5 years ago to where we are right now. Zoom out, don't look at the kind of like what is happening this year. Zoom out and really look at what is going on, and think for yourself, like what is going to happen in the next 5 years. So brain computer interfaces at this point, I think they are not only an exciting way for us to move towards the future. They become necessity if we want to keep up with the future.
I think one of the caveats of looking at advances over time is that you also need to look at how much budgets are into certain technologies.
Mm-hmm.
And I think most of the counter arguments I see for AI progress or even BCI progress is that yes, you get more progress, but you need to, invest much more money. 200 years ago, you could have scientists alone doing progress on, electricity or iron production, and
yeah.
Now you need more and more researchers to sustain this AI growth or Moore's law growth. And I guess BCI has made a lot of progress, but 10 years ago there were maybe 10 times or 100 times less companies that they exist today.
Mm-hmm.
So if we want to keep up, if we cannot just extrapolate the data from the last 5 years and say we're going to have that much progress, because it requires even larger amounts of investment. And I think for brain, for neuroscience, one stat people often cite is that we only know about 3% or something about how the brain works. I don't know anything about this percentage, but maybe if we only understood that much now, maybe we would need more money to understand more. And yeah, and there's a larger fraction to understand.
Yeah. I'll give an example with regards to, do we really require understanding of something? Look at the ant colony. You can understand an ant and kind of understand its biology and its neuroscience, how its brain works, to a certain degree, yeah? It's a very simple system. But when we see this kind of network of ants communicating with each other, we have another level of abstraction. An organism emerges, an intelligence emerges from simple rules. I think it's a similar thing is going to happen or is happening right now with AI. It doesn't necessarily require us engineering every little part of it. It requires the system, there is a probability that the system is going to emerge just from these kind of simple parts once they are connected and they have communication. And there is an architecture that will emerge. There will be bottom up emergence where the system is going to operate to stay alive as a whole. It might kind of sacrifice its components, some ants die, some ants are born, but the ant colony survives for years. No ant, except for maybe queen, no ant lives that long compared to the ant colony. And the ant colony, think about that. The ant colony sends queens to form other ant colonies. So if we think about it, when the ant colony dies, does it really die? Or that did it just copy it and kind of, not copy it, but propagated itself and multiplied itself and distributed itself to become even more you can think of the whole ant species as a one big organism, and the same for humans. It's just the amount of communication that we have is, the speed of communication is different, and with brain computer interfaces, that speed of communication is going to increase, and you can think of what that might result into.
I think the main difference between ants and humans is that ants have all the same intelligence, or maybe some can carry a bit more, some maybe queens or kings of ants that can do other things. But if you get an AI that is able to self-improve and rewrite its own code, or even just AI that are trained with much more compute, think about GPT-3 or larger models that require more investments in code, those models are going to get smarter or more powerful. And so we're not going to get this nice distribution of a bird flocking or ants. We're going to get something heterogeneous. Oh, because, I don't see why, how we could get a billion times a billion GPT-3 or GPT-4. Like the largest investment is so huge that we cannot like replicate it everywhere. You cannot deploy GPT-3 on your own GPU because it requires many GPUs. So yeah, I think there's going to be like some heterogeneous progress.
I mean, okay, I understand your point. You're talking about once the system is kind of like a GPT-3, which is like kind of isolated and it's kind of, it's like supposed to be like very intelligent, so it's not, I wouldn't call like GPT-3 as a like a distributed system. Yeah, it's kind of centralized in a way. Right. But you can think of like the internet itself and humanity, that what we have right now, we already have an intelligence that is emerging on a kind of a level that where messages are traveling in the form of, you know, simple form like memes, and like there is a, like more like complex messages. But what would happen? That's an open question. What would happen once we increase the speed of communication between separate nodes? And the way to think about that, you can look at the history of communication and ask yourself what happened in the past once we, when we didn't have that much of coupling between people, between machines, what was the rate of the progress compared to what it is right now when we do have high coupling and we can message someone on like another in another location in the world like instantly.
So yeah, let's talk about that. Like for instance, I remember using Skype when I was a kid, so let's say 10 to 15 years ago. Now we're using some video call. Have we really improved our bandwidth of communication over the past 15 years?
I think so, in a way that it's kind of the protocols of video communication are like on a technical level, they might have improved, but like there's no noticeable difference. But our protocol of communication changed in as human beings in a way that I don't remember people talking too much to complete strangers back then. Like you, like the Skype, you know, Skype was used like either for like to talking with your family members or your like business kind of environment, and just phone, like just calling just random person in the world. It's it was not something that was very widespread. Now it's very common. Like you contact a lot of, like I contact a lot of people on a basis of, on a weekly basis. So and like with some of them I have calls. So how we kind of changed our approach to what it takes us to connect with other person and exchange useful information and maybe never see them again, but you know, like we expanded our reach, like so, the brain expanded its reach to access more information.
That's more like a cultural change, and I wonder how much of it is from COVID and social distancing. Maybe in the past 10 years it's been more accepted to network through video chats than, and people before used to talk with their families. I still think there's, you know, I think even in BCI there's we still haven't reached the killer app that we can just say, oh yeah, now I can exchange much more information with you, or much more experience. And so that's some, I guess my question was, because we've seen a huge progress in AI in the past 10 years, an explosion in deep learning, and I haven't seen yet an explosion in, you know, the BCI space, except from maybe number of companies and number of people working on it.
Yes.
My question is like, even if we, you know, if AI progress stops for the next 10 to 20 years, maybe BCI could, you know, catch up and we could accelerate human intelligence by having higher bandwidths, more communication. But given that like AI might advance rapidly at the same rate that it's advanced in the past, do you see BCI, you know, catching up, or will we reach something like general intelligence before we get any better communication between me and you?
Okay. With regards to BCIs, that's how I think of them in terms of what we need to improve faster. First of all, we need the devices to be distributed among people, kind of like we have laptops and phones. We don't actually think about them that much, but like owning a smartphone like 20 years ago or something, that was like a big deal. Yeah, so it's like the BCIs need to be distributed in a way that like they are on consumer like accessible on consumer basis. But with regards to how fast we progress from that point when people actually have brain computer interfaces, imagine I have a kind of invasive brain chip in my brain that is connected to neurons, and it has kind of threads like that kind of connect to your brain. Once we kind of start like our thinking process, there will be some kind of activations in that chip that will transfer some neural firing information. I'm not talking about any concepts or like words or anything like that. No, purely neuron firings, like purely like electrical signals. Just on the basis of that, I think there will be already some kind of a link between our brains, and we would start to probably notice that in the same way how they have Siamese twins, or how they are called, when they are merged on the level of their brains, and they can kind of experience what they can close their eyes and they can sort of see with their twins' eyes. And you know, it requires a communication between neurons on a very low level. Everything else is going to emerge just by network adjusting itself, like our brain adjusting to its communication, just like we adjusted, you know, just like you adjusted to kind of typing fast when you just learned to type and you advanced and now you type fast because you kind of have a map, like internal map of the keyboard. The same way there will be an internal map of communication with something outside, whether it will be your brain or whether it will be an artificial intelligent system. Here's the thing. Our brain is very flexible, and it consists of very repetitive kind of blocks or like modules. And these modules, they operate based on what inputs they have and what outputs they have. So if you connect something, if you plug in something in your area of the brain, for example, if you plug in your visual kind of processing system, like some kind of signal about, so how they would do studies with people who like are blind, yeah? They would put some kind of vibrotactile, like basically like motors on like on like a part of your body, and basically kind of you can learn to see not only with your eyes, but you can learn to see with your skin. It will be low resolution, but you can kind of, if you can plug in a camera, video stream camera, that would stimulate your kind of skin, the area of the brain that is connected to that skin will start to be responsible for vision.
So the part of my brain connected, so you can, so are you saying that there is like neuroplasticity and I can reprogram my brain to do other things?
Exactly. There is a, that I'm talking about neuroplasticity. So like that's why communication, like once we kind of connect ourselves to either each other or AI systems, we will just, based on our goals that we would have at that time, we will learn to utilize those connections to achieve goals. And if that means a faster exchange of information or you know, better chances of surviving in some, like in some situations, the brain will most probably adjust.
Okay, so kind of the approach of Neuralink where they implant the electrode and then they say we just you know, recording what it says and inputting things, but we're just like putting this interface that is very, with a lot of electrodes, and we expect the brain to itself be a good you know, a good a good interface with this interface, like adapt to this interface. And
a simple way to think about it, you don't tell weight, you don't tell neural network its weights, you just tell it the cost function, the optimization function, and the weights are being adjusted and calculated based on that. So the same thing with for example, with what Neuralink does, for example, if you've seen the monkey video where a monkey kind of played the game, they didn't actually map like the game to specific like neurons in the monkey's brain and how to, which neuron to fire and stuff. They just probably went through some kind of calibration process where they gave like monkeys a time to play in the environment, and they gave monkey a reward, like some kind of juice, similar to how reinforcement agent would operate. And the monkey would just, to get the reward, the monkey would learn how to operate in the game and how to win in the game, because it gets rewarded. The brain will seek for like more reward, and it will learn how to get it.
Yeah, I've seen that video. It's pretty crazy. I'll probably link it in the description. My question is, do you think we're going to, we're using this in monkeys to do simple things like click on this and move a character to get some treasure and a map? When do you think we'll achieve something like Siamese brains, where or Siamese twins, where they like connected in their nerves, and you said they could like see the other person's eyes, the other person's, what the other person will be looking at. I think it's crazy if that's true, but so would we need to just like, I don't know, have an interface in our neck that is connected to someone else and be able to record this and send it back? When do you think we could achieve something like that? That would be crazy.
I think,
if ever possible, of course.
I think once we have a proper brain-computer interface that can handle read and write signals into the brain on a very local scale, to the local scale of neurons and the scale of people in the stadium, once we have that in a way that it's safe and you can kind of connect that to many, many, many neurons, I think there is nothing that stops, and you can connect like two people like that. There is nothing that will stop the progress from that stage, in a way that the communication protocol will be developed, kind of on it. It will emerge based on the tasks that are given. If you are interested, there are actually studies where people used non-invasive brain computer interface to play, I think, Tetris game. So what they did, there is a kind of, I think two persons are connected with a non-invasive brain computer interface where you can kind of read a brain signal and stimulate the brain signal, I think with like transcranial magnetic stimulation. So you have some kind of a feeling that you're stimulated. Like, I haven't had like such experience with magnetic stimulation, but you can imagine that your state is somehow, you can feel something is different. So you can say, okay, I can differentiate between a signal where I'm not stimulated and where I am stimulated. Okay, so what they did, they would put one person in a room with a game, and a person would observe the game, but person would have no control in terms of making decisions. Like, person would basically only have a visual input, but it has no way of controlling the game. And in the other room, there is a person who has no visual input from the game. It only has a kind of input, this kind of connection with another brain through brain computer interfaces, and they can differentiate between kind of different signals and like, or learn between like different signals and kind of understand where, and they have access to control, like of joystick, and you can kind of these people learn how to play this game, even though one person only had access to visual input and the other person only had access to the joystick.
It's very
non-invasively and very low resolution signal. And I think like the game was very simple, maybe not even Tetris, but with like it's possible once you have a proper goals to reach to optimize.
So you would kind of get some signals from the other person, and you would understand that the person is seeing left or seeing. So the person with joystick would not see the screen.
Yes.
That's super. Yeah, if we can scale it up, that would be awesome.
And it even doesn't matter like whether it's another person, whether it's AI system, whether it's like a simple algorithm that computes something. When you kind of receive this signal, and if it's in a way you kind of think it's useful, like your brain thinks it's useful, it will learn to utilize it, and learn to kind of to differentiate between patterns in that signal, to have this kind of close feedback loop where it would do something to produce a change, and it will like, okay, if I do this, I receive this kind of signal, but if I do that, I receive that kind of signal. Okay, so now I see the mapping, and you basically learn to predict this, the external system.
And maybe the extreme case, if we push it to the limit, is what you have called, I think previously, brain swarm, where we're all like being able to kind of play the video game or feeling what other people are feeling. And so that's like when we're like all like if AI doesn't go that fast or fast enough to have good BCI technology but not enough to self-improve, we would have billions of people being able to connect themselves via some interfaces and feel what the other person is feeling and thinking, maybe in symbiosis. Could you describe a bit more like your ideal future of brain swarm that you think about?
So we can start from a brain swarm already in the present time and look at the system like Twitter or like is a good example where people would just share their thoughts. You have some kind of thought and you like, well, why not share it? And you share it with external world and some people kind of read that information from a complete stranger and they upvote it, not only on the basis like to kind of give some kind of reward to the person, but also to adjust the Twitter algorithm for themselves, like give me more of this stuff. You know, like I want more like that similar information. So like it's a, like you can act in this system as an agent that is kind of optimizes its information kind of inputs in the same way how I just told you about you kind of receive the signal and you do something which is like or retweet and you receive more of that of similar signal. So that is going to like with brain computer interfaces, it is going to be enhanced because of the speed. We will not need to type. We currently use our visual system to process information or like to get the initial input, but in the future with brain-computer interfaces, you can imagine that this will be on a much faster level where possibly language will become obsolete. So because language is kind of a compression of our real thoughts, of our real intentions, we compress this information in order for, because like there is a limitation on how many words we can actually deliver. And then you need in your brain to decompress that information have a meaning of what I've just said. So you see the amount of steps it takes. That's number one. And number two, we can see why there are like differences between people, why there is misunderstanding in like different cultures and stuff like that. With brain computer interfaces, we might not need a language as a way to communicate. It's speculation, but we might develop a faster protocol to communicate where we do not need such compression of information in order to transmit it.
Yeah, that's exciting. Yeah, funny enough, you've been talking about Twitter. So I've checked Twitter when I ask people about questions, and I just got one more question for you from someone that posted like a few minutes ago. And it's exactly about human language, which is, they linked to an article saying that human speech may have a universal transmission rate of 39 bits per second. So if we should be able, so in your view, if that's correct, we should be able to bypass this frontier of language, because that's 39 bits is not enough to have high information.
And think about how exciting it is that we've just spoke about it and someone asked about it. I mean, it could be a coincidence. It could be a statistical coincidence. But there is a probability that we are so connected in a way how, I'm not talking about like physical connection with some kind of telepathy. I'm talking about how the system, the people and the AIs are already in a way kind of, the ideas emerge and travel. You can notice a lot of like coincidences with like a recommendation system, like how you get recommended something of more of what you searched before, or like what you thought about, you get recommended that. And there is a probability that that will just happen.
Yeah, that's awesome. That maybe you were also checking Twitter, so you started talking about it because you said. Okay, and now the final result. So after we get something smarter than humans, AI smarter than humans, if I remember correctly, you believe in brain uploads, and you believe that humans could be able to upload themselves into a server and. Talk between them faster.
Okay, I don't necessarily believe in the in a way that we can upload ourselves without any changes. Like in a way that we are talking about like future, so we're not talking about like tomorrow. But like in a way that I think once we, it will be possible to upload ourselves. I think it will change the way how we are. And for example, like first, certainly the speed, but maybe like there will be some impact where changing the architecture, changing the hardware might impact like the way how we generate, like how the system generates kind of how intelligent it is. Because there is also, think about it this way. If you replace right now your in your brain one neuron, just one neuron with artificial neuron, and just let it be there as a part of a system, are you artificial right now? Well, you're kind of a cyborg in a way, but it's just one neuron. Now, what if you replace two neurons? What if you replace 10, 1,000? How many neurons does it take for you to actually be considered that you digitally upload yourself? And you can kind of think that maybe we will get there gradually. So it will not be like a discrete upload. Yeah, like, oh, I just upload myself right now. And it's like a one-time thing. But it will be more of a gradual thing where we kind of replace our body parts, kind of like with prosthetics here, replace our brain parts or like augment them in a way that... we move into a digital medium gradually. And I'm not talking about it will most probably be it will be a copy. It's not kind of it's a copy, it's not actually you. But in a way, if you think about it, tomorrow we are going to wake up, and during the sleep, our brain is going to be adjusted. Our brain is going to be changed. Think of like there will be some modifications in the system. So tomorrow we will be a new kind of a person, a little bit different from what we are right now. So you can think of that is already like our current versions of ourselves. They will not be there. They will not be here tomorrow. They will be they will be like a slightly updated versions that think that they were the same person from the yesterday.
So if you copy the version that is here now and you put it in a server with the same memories, do you think this person will believe it is me?
I have seen that in sci-fi movies in terms of like this thing. So my thinking is currently
intuitively
biased. Yes, my thinking is currently biased with what I've seen, how that what might happen next, and will person, like the digital person, will it perceive itself as a like that it was in the past, like a biological being. So yeah, I don't know how that is going to, like, how exactly that is going to operate, but in a way that what I've just described with the sleep, if you think about, like, sleep is kind of as modification, it's not replacing neurons, but like let's think that it's like some kind of modifications of connections between them. So it's not the same type of model of you. It's just not a cop, like your copy from the yesterday does not exist. So it's not preserved anywhere. But with digital upload, it is preserved. Like it stays in the body. You know what I mean?
And okay, so the copy, if you have a digital copy, it stays, you still have your version here and you can copy it somewhere else.
Yes, so that's why it's a copy. But when you sleep, it's not like...
It's a replacement.
Yeah, it's a replacement.
And imagine... So yeah, do you see it as something positive, as if like humans, or maybe we get to something like a singularity, we get very smart AI that can self-improve, and maybe human labor is not very useful anymore, and people start doing, you know, copies of themselves, and to put them like on a central server to do something like a brain swarm or like a brain upload swarm. Do you see something that as a positive, a successful, story for the human race, or would you be happy to like just die and you being a copy inside this giant server?
Like right now, we can judge like our current world compared to 100 years ago. Did we, like, was this technological improvement an improvement? Like, are we actually better off? And like subjectively, I can say yes. Like there are like more people are educated, and like the exchange of information is faster. There is there is a diversification. We are becoming more kind of liberal, and those are kind of, I view them as good things for the system. Will it kind of move in the same direction in the future, in a way that it will kind of be better for the system in the future? I think that the system in the future, like the system will try to optimize for whatever it is best for it, for itself. Yeah, like the system wouldn't want to give itself like some kind of punishment just for no reason. Like the system will want to optimize some kind of more rewards, more kind of to have a state where it has access to more resources. So from it could be from the system perspective in the future, it would respond, I feel good, like I feel happy, whatever that means for that system. From our point right now, if we would judge from the past, like right now, to how it is in the future, and we will see that future, we might agree or disagree in the same way how people 100 years ago would agree or disagree with the way how we live right now. You know, I think there will be people who would say, you've got like what you're doing wrong is completely like you're stuck in your phones, you're looking at this, like, what is going on? But there will be people, presumably from like maybe like science community, who will be like, you know, applauding to what we are doing now.
So so you've talked about addiction. And I think our reward function is not perfect, because we can, you know, take heroin or MDMA and just be full of dopamine without achieving something objectively, you know, good for the world. And so we have this like reward function from, you know, evolutionary fitness, that people could argue that is not the best reward function, because humans like think about other things that doesn't give direct rewards. So, and we also talked about Facebook, that you believe at the beginning was about connecting people, and now as like with the capitalist model and the ads revenue has changed to something where they like drive click. For me it's like a bit hard to see why the natural like capitalism and you know, evolutionary pressures would bring us to a good reward function or a good loss function for an AI, and we will be like very lucky if we get to like a good loss function by chance or and by an emergent behavior without like defining it properly.
Okay, yes, it's currently hard to predict with regards to what is the fate of a biological human being in the future. It's something that if we extrapolate into the future and think about will a human being stay a biological human being, well, we already have evolution, which is biological, so like possibly like even if no progress is happening, we would still have some kind of changing in the human species. But with like adding technology progress, I think that like human beings, like a lot of adaptation needs to happen for us to be able to kind of exist, survive in the future world. Like staying as a human being, I believe it's a choice that should be given to everybody. Like if you want to kind of augment yourself or stay a human being, you're free to choose. It will be driven kind of by some kind of a game theory where what happens if you don't augment yourself? Like, can you live with the fact that there will be beings that are like more intelligent? Even though you don't know, maybe they destroy themselves tomorrow. Like, you don't know how things are kind of going to happen if you augment yourself. But just judging by the present moment, if you see like someone is augmenting themselves and they receive kind of more resources, more this, more that, what's your internal thinking when you kind of like, what would a typical human being do in this situation?
I think that's a great question for people to keep thinking about after the podcast, because it will be a central theme in the next decades. I think we covered a lot of things, and I'm quite happy about the end of the discussion. If people want to learn more about your work, do you have like a new website or Twitter account that people can follow?
I have a Twitter account, and I have like LinkedIn account, but like my goal is to the field right now needs a lot of people for it to progress, and like we need kind of diversification in skills. It doesn't matter if you kind of come from a non-neuroscientific field. I myself, I don't come from a neuroscience background. I self-taught, so it doesn't matter what your background is, as long as you are kind of passionate about this and you want to. People who get in right now, since the field is in its infancy, are going to define the future of this field. So for the people who are like are listening to this, if you want to get on board and basically impact and contribute to how the future is going to operate, neurotech field is one of the best fields to do so.
Awesome. Yeah, it's a great conclusion. Thanks a lot for being on the podcast. Hopefully, we can have another discussion in a few years to talk about advances. And yeah, I wish you a great day.
Yeah, you too. Thank you.